Hello students, welcome back to our class. Let us start with the integral domain and field, which is the next topic of our fifth unit in ring theory. So let us begin to our discussion on the integral domain and field. Okay, so before that I'll just like to give you one more example of a ring, so which is the ring of integers modulo n. So in group theory probably you have done the group of integers modulo n. So it is a set which contains the elements 0, 1, 2 up to n minus 1, right? And the operations are the addition modulo n and multiplication modulo n. Okay. So what is this modular addition and modular multiplication? Let us see. A plus modulo n with b is the least non-negative remainder when a plus b is divided by n. Okay, and a cross modulo b n, it is the least non-negative remainder when a into b is divided by n. Okay, under these two operations the above set is a ring. Okay, so it is called the ring of integers modulo n, right? So let us see one of these composition. How to find out what are the elements, or how to add and multiply the elements of this ring. Okay, so let us have a look at that, right? So for example, Z4 is a ring, so we can form the composition table for Z4 with respect to addition as this. So in group theory you have formed. So the elements of the set are from 0, 1, 2 up to 3. So the elements are written row wise as well as column wise. Okay. So and the operation is written in the left, top left corner. Okay. So it's this plus modulo 4 of this. Okay. So the element written in row is added with the element written in the column. Okay, so that way we fill up this table, okay, which is also called Kelly's table, right? So 0 plus 0 is 0. 0 when divided by 4, the remainder is 0. Okay, so it's 0. 0 plus 1 is 1, and when 1 is divided by 4, the remainder is 1. Okay, 0 plus 2 is 2, and when it is divided by 4, the remainder is 2. Okay, 0 plus 3 is 3, and the remainder when divided by 4 is also 3. Okay, so then 1 plus 0 is 1, and the remainder is also 1. 1 plus 1 is 2, when you divide by 4, remainder is 2. 1 plus 2 is 3, if you divide by 4, remainder is 3. 1 plus 3 is 4, and if you divide by 4, the remainder here is 0. Okay, clear? So similarly, 2 plus 0 is 2, if you divide by 4, remainder is 2. 2 plus 1 is 3, divide by 4, remainder is 3. Okay, 2 plus 2 is 4, divide by 4, the remainder comes out to be 0. Okay, so that way we can form the composition table of this particular ring. Okay, so it will be required for our discussion. Let n be a positive integer, and let a comma b belongs to be any integers. Then we say that a is congruent to b modulo n if n divides a minus b. Okay, so for example, 12 is congruent to 5 modulo 7, right? 12 is congruent to 5 modulo 7, that means 12 minus 5 is divisible by 7. Okay, similarly 12 minus minus 2, that is 14. 14 is also divisible by 7, so 12 is congruent to minus 2 modulo 7, right? Similarly 3 is congruent to minus 2 modulo 5. Okay, so these are two of the important properties of congruences. A congruent to B modulo n if and C is congruent to B D modulo n, then A plus C is also congruent to B plus D modulo n. Okay, and AC is congruent to BD modulo n. So when we deal with the ring Zn, we will require some of these properties. Okay, so suppose I get A plus C as 7 in Z4, in that case that 7 will be taken as the congruent to the integer that is divisible by 4. Okay, if any integer a is divided by n, the only possible remainders are 0, 1, 2 up to n minus 1. So if we subtract the remainder from a, then n divides a minus r. Okay, so a is congruent to r modulo n. Okay, so that is the easiest way to find out an integer is congruent to which particular integer. Okay, modulo some given integer. So for example, if you divide 3 by 5, so under modulo 5 arithmetic, 3 is congruent to 3 only. Okay, so the remainder when 3 is divided by 5. Under modulo 7, okay, 12 is congruent to what under modulo 7? If you divide 12 by 7, the remainder comes out to be 5. So 12 is congruent to 5 modulo 7. Okay, it may be congruent to other numbers as well. Okay, but in terms of remainder, if we say any number is congruent to the remainder when it is divided by that modulo number. Okay, so this will be used. So let us come to the definition of this zero divisors. So a non-zero element in a commutative ring R is called a zero divisor if there is a non-zero element in R such that AB equal to zero. Okay, that means if product of two non-zero elements is zero, then each of the non-zero elements is a zero divisor. Okay, so in the ring Z6 of integers modulo 6, we have 2 is non-zero, 3 is also non-zero, but if you take the product 2 into 3 under modulo 6 operation, it's 0 because 2 into 3 is 6. When you divide 6 by 6, the remainder is 0. Okay, so that is why 2 into 3 under modulo 6 operation is 0. So in Z6, 2 and 3 are 0 divisors. Okay, none of them is 0, but their product is 0. Right, similarly, 4 is also a 0 divisor because if we take 4 into 3, 4 into 3 is 12, and when you divide 12 by 6, the remainder is 0. Okay, so but 1 belongs to Z6 is not a 0 divisor. You can try multiplying the given elements by 1, then what you get is just the remainders. Okay, so each of these remainders is non-zero. So there is no non-zero element of Z6 whose product with 1 is 0. That means 1 is not a 0 divisor. Okay, so if A is a 0 divisor, we should be able to find another non-zero element B such that the product AB is 0. So what is an integral domain? A commutative ring with unity is said to be an integral domain if it has no zero divisors. Okay, so if there are no zero divisors, we will say that the ring is an integral domain. Okay, so but it has to be commutative ring with unity. Okay, there should be an element 1 such that the product of any element with it is the element itself. Okay, so thus in an integral domain, the product of non-zero elements cannot be 0. Okay, so if R is an integral domain, then for any AB belongs to R, then we can write the following equivalent statement. Whenever AB is 0, then either A is 0 or B is 0. Okay, right? Product of non-zero elements cannot be 0, right? So A not equal to 0, B not equal to 0 implies AB is non-zero, right? And the equivalent form is AB equal to 0 implies A equal to 0 or B equal to 0. Okay, so if we get that, then the ring is said to be an integral domain. So for example, the ring Z of integers with respect to usual addition and multiplication is an integral domain. Okay, and the ring of rational numbers with respect to usual addition and multiplication is also an integral domain. Okay, product of two non-zero integers cannot be 0, product of two non-zero rationals cannot be 0. Okay, similarly, product of two reals non-zero reals cannot be 0. Okay, so the ring of real numbers with respect to usual addition and multiplication, it is also an integral domain. Okay, then the ring Z5 equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 with respect to addition and multiplication modulo 5 is an integral domain. Okay, this can be seen from the composition table. Okay, if you just take the product composition table of the product, you can see that the product of non-zero elements is never 0. Okay, if you just concentrate on this part, the product of non-zero elements here is not 0. Okay, so Z5 is an integral domain, right? So product of non-zero elements is non-zero, so Z5 is an integral domain. Then the ring is in general Zp equal to 0, 1, 2 up to p minus 1 of integers modulo p, where p is a prime number, is an integral domain. Okay, this is because the only way p can be written as a product is p equal to 1 into p, because since p is a prime number, the only factors of p are 1 and itself. The only positive factors of p are 1 and itself. So p cannot be written as product of elements of Zp, because Zp contains elements which are less than p. Okay, so we cannot write P is a product of elements of P. Okay. So if P is a ring, if P is prime, then ZP is an integral domain. Okay. So if P is not prime, then ZP is not an integral domain. So Z8 is 0, 1, 2 up to 7. It is not an integral domain because there exist zero divisors. Okay. So 2, 4, 6, they are all zero divisors. If you take 2 and 4, if you multiply them, the product is 8, which is whose remainder when divided by 8 is 0. Okay, so 2 and 4 are 0 divisors. We have also seen other, Z6 is not an integral domain because it has 0 divisors. Okay. So, one theorem, cancellation in integral domain. Okay, let D be an integral domain and A, B, C, D be any element, A, B, and C be any element. If A is non-zero and AB equal to AC, okay, then we can cancel. We can write B equal to C. Okay, so usually we do that in our maths classes. Whenever we have some expression like twice X equal to twice Y, we just cancel 2 on both sides. Okay, so that can be done in an integral domain. Okay, so whenever AB equal to AC and A is non-zero, we can divide both sides by A. Okay. So here the concept of division hasn't come till now. The concept of division will come in case of field. Okay. So here we are not saying we are dividing by A. We are saying that whenever AB and AC are equal, B and C should be equal. Okay. Because it is given that A is non-zero and AB equal to AC. So you take AB AC to the other side, then AB minus AC is zero. So A into B minus C is zero. Now D is an integral domain. And we have got that the product of A and B minus C is 0. So that means any one of them should be 0. Okay. So here A is already given to be non-zero. That means B minus C has to be 0. Because in an integral domain, product of non-zero elements cannot be 0. Okay. So A and B minus C cannot be simultaneously non-zero. So since A is non-zero, the other one has to be 0. So B minus C has to be 0. So B equal to C. So in an integral domain, the cancellation laws hold. Okay. Another one is a non-zero element of a commutative ring with unity is said to be a unit if it has a multiplicative inverse. Okay. Thus, U belongs to R is said to be a unit if there exists a V in R such that U into V is 1. Okay. And this V is also denoted by U inverse. Okay. So a non-zero element is said to be a unit if it has multiplicative inverse. Okay, means if we can find another element whose product with this element is 1. Okay, so it's denoted by U inverse. For example, in the ring of real numbers under usual addition and multiplication, every non-zero element is a unit, just as 2 is a unit because 1 by 2 is an R and 2 into 1 by 2 is 1. Okay, similarly root 3 by 2 is a unit because if you just multiply with the reciprocal, the product comes out to be 1. Okay, and in the ring Z6, the element 5 is a unit because 5, you take the product with 5 itself, the remainder comes out to be 5 into 5 is 25. If you divide 25 by 6, the remainder is 1. Okay, so that means 5 is a unit here, right? So no, we don't have anything like 1 by 5 in Z6. Okay, so the 5 is a unit and it is its own inverse. Okay, 5 inverse is same as 5. Okay, so what is a field? A commutative ring with unity is called a field if every non-zero element is a unit. That is, every non-zero element in that ring has a multiplicative inverse. Okay, so note that it has to be commutative ring with unity, otherwise it's not a field. Okay, so the ring of real numbers with respect to usual addition and multiplication of real numbers is a field as the inverse of any non-zero element A belongs to R is its reciprocal, that is 1 by A. Okay. So we have a very important theorem here. What is that? Every field is an integral domain. Okay. So if you know that a ring is a field, then we can say that it is also an integral domain. Okay. So how to prove this? Let F be a field and A comma B belongs to F, B and A element such that A into B is 0. So what I have to show? I have to show that either A is 0 or B is 0. Okay. So suppose that A is non-zero, then A inverse belongs to F because F is a field. Field, in a field, every non-zero element has a multiplicative inverse. So since A is non-zero, so it will have some multiplicative inverse, say A inverse. okay, which is there, which is also an element inside F. So we can multiply by A inverse. So A inverse multiplied with AB will be A inverse into 0, that is 0, okay. And then you can apply the associative property of multiplication, okay. So A inverse A into B is 0. So 1 into B is 0, that is B is 0, right. So if A is non-zero, then B has to be 0. And similarly, if B is non-zero, then B inverse is also an element of F, since F is a field. So we can multiply, post multiply both side by B inverse. So A is 0. So either A is 0 or B is 0. Whenever AB is 0, either A is 0 or B is 0. So F has to be an integral domain. So this proves that every field is an integral domain. Okay. But the converse is not true. Every integral domain may not be a field. Okay. So what is that? Special case is there. If you have a finite integral domain, then it is always a field. Okay. So this is the theorem. Every finite integral domain is a field. Let D be a finite integral domain with unity 1, and let A belongs to D be any non-zero element. If A equal to 1, then A is its own inverse. Okay. Inverse of 1 is 1. So let A not equal to 1. So let us consider the sequence of elements A, A square, A cube, A to the power 4. Okay, that way we keep on writing the powers of A. Okay. So since D is finite, so this list cannot continue indefinitely. Okay. Since D is a finite set, so this list must stop somewhere. Okay. That means after some stage, there should be repetition. Okay. The same things should keep on coming. Right, so this is what I have written. It cannot happen since D is finite, so it cannot happen that all elements in the list are distinct. Okay, so there exist I and J such that I is greater than J and AI is equal to AJ. Okay, A to the power I is equal to A to the power J. So after some stage, the elements must repeat. Okay, so there exist I and J such that I greater than J and AI equal to AJ. Okay, since cancellation laws hold in an integral domain, and since A is non-zero, so we can multiply both sides by A inverse. Okay, or just we can no need to multiply by A inverse. Yeah, it's the same thing, but we are applying the cancellation law actually. Okay, so we are applying the cancellation law. So A to the power I minus 1 into I equal to A to the power J minus 1 into J into A. So since A is non-zero, we can cancel A on both sides. So it's A to the power I minus 1 equal to J to the power I minus 1. A to the power J minus 1. Then you keep on repeating this process, right? Implies A to the power I minus 2 equal to A to the power J minus 2, right? We can just extract one A at a time. Okay, so repeating the cancellation J times. So J times we can repeat. So we get A to the power I minus J is 1. But A is not equal to 1, so that means I minus J cannot be 0. If I minus J is 0, then by definition A to the power 0 is 1. If I minus J is equal to 1, then A to the power I minus J is also 1. That is A equal to 1. But we have already taken that A is not equal to 1. So I minus J has to be greater than 1. Okay, so we can extract still another A from here. Okay, so A to the power I minus J equal to 1 can be written as A to the power I minus J minus 1 into A equal to 1. Okay, so this part is nothing but the inverse of A. So A inverse equal to A to the power I minus J minus 1. So what I have shown? I have shown that if you take any arbitrary element of the finite integral domain, then we also see that it has its inverse. Okay, A inverse can be found out. Okay, in fact, we have given the construction of the construction process of A inverse, how to construct A inverse, right? So hence D is a field. Every finite integral domain is a field. Okay. So using this theorem, we can also prove this particular result, which I had already stated. ZP, where P is a prime, is a field. Okay. So since ZP is a finite set, so it is enough to show that it is an integral domain, because every finite integral domain is a field. Okay. So it is enough to show that it is an integral domain. So let A comma B belongs to ZP be such that A cross modulo P of B is 0. So that means what? Remainder when AB is divided by P is 0. So that means P divides AB. Okay. The remainder is 0. That means PDB divides AB. AB is divisible by P. So from here we can write P divides A or P divides B, since P is a prime number. Okay. If P is not prime, then we cannot write. because p is a prime, only then only because of that we can write. So p divides a or p divides b. So this is actually called Euclid's lemma, right? And so a is congruent to 0 modulo p. P divides a man means p divides a minus 0. Okay, so p is a is congruent to 0 mod p, or b is congruent to 0 mod p. That means either a is 0 or b is 0. We had started with elements of the ZP. Okay, so what are the elements of ZP which are congruent to 0? Only 0, right? Only 0 is congruent to 0. So either a is 0 or b is 0. Hence ZP is a finite integral domain, and so it is a field. Okay, every finite integral domain is a field, right? So for your course of fifth unit, I think this much will be sufficient. In the next lecture, I'll probably start with normal subgroups and all. Okay, you please let me know which topic you want to discuss, right? Thank you.